Welcome, everybody. My name is Gabriel Díaz, and I'm the director of the MA TESOL program and chair of English language studies here at the new school. And together with my colleague, Caitlin Morgan, director of ESL programs, we are very, very proud to give you a warm welcome to the new school, particularly to Andrea and Maria, and our co-authors in the book. I have a little story to tell. This story starts sometime in December 2009, when I got an email saying that two professors from Molloy College were looking for co-authors for a book on collaboration and co-teaching. At the time, I was working and living in Montevideo, Uruguay, South America, and not in my wildest dreams was I thinking that I would be standing here in front of you with them presenting the book to you guys. Here at the New School, we're very, very proud to have been part of this project, and we look forward to many more collaboration and co-teaching, projects in years to come. So without further ado, please welcome Maria and Andrea.
So we're going to have a short introduction to our panel discussion. Those are the next two agenda items, and we hope that you're going to stay around after the more formal part of our evening and mix and mingle with everybody, meet all of us, enjoy the refreshments, and have a collaborative conversation with all of us.
You're welcome.
Okay. So we thought that we have to start somewhere. We're going to give you a historical overview how we reached the age of collaboration. So we have to take you through the ages. Why don't we go all the way back to the Stone Age and the Bronze Age and the Iron Age, the Dark Age, the Modern Age, and the Computer Age? We've always been battling some kind of a tool, correct? And we would all agree that we live in the Information Age or the Computer Age. Well, that's what we thought until we came across Grace Rubinstein's really brilliant article in Edutopia, of all places, where she said, and we quote, "Information age, rest in pieces. This is the collaboration age. Our success, our future success, depends on our cooperative agility." And this became our motto. We really believe in that. And Maria is the techie. She has a website for us. She does everything on the computer. We're videoing teachers, doing co-teaching. So we believe in technology, certainly, but we also firmly believe that this is the age of collaboration, a very critical 21st century skill for everybody, especially for teachers and educators.
So we'd like to share with you how we really got started on this journey. Andrea co-taught in New York City, and then I co-taught, and we didn't know each other at this time, in Valley Stream, New York. My co-teaching stemmed from there was a large population of students, and there wasn't enough room for these individual ESL classes. So the administrator at the time said, well, just push in and pull aside your students. And that wasn't working out very well. At the time, I had taken a course in literacy, and I had a friend in first grade that I was pushing into, whose class I was pushing into. And I said, Eileen, I said, I have this idea of building a word wall. Could I come in and try and spend the time I'm supposed to push in and pull aside to work full whole class with your students? And she said, sure, come on in. And that's how my co-teaching began, in this very small way. The other first grade teachers walked by the room, saw me in front of their class, snapping and clamping and stomping all the word wall words we were building for the word wall. And they were interested, and they said, could you come in my class and do that too? And little by little, the co-teaching program was built from first grade down to kindergarten up through third grade.
And our collaboration then continued through Molloy College. And if you've never heard of Molloy College, don't feel bad. It's not Molloy College, it's Molloy. It's the best kept secret of Long Island, at least that's how we like to talk about it. And I think our new president has really put the college on the map. So if you Google us, you will find Molloy College. That's where we both are. I've been there for 12 years, and I was actually hired there to start a master's program in TESOL in the year 2000. And as the program grew faster than we anticipated at that time, we needed more and more adjunct professors and full-time professors. So,
and I came on board at first as an adjunct and came on later on.
And now she has my job and she can keep it. So Maria is now the coordinator of the master's program in TESOL, and they pulled me in another direction.
Moral of the story, be careful what you wish for.
Yes. Okay, so we started with articles and presentations. We have several articles. Maria will show you the website where we actually host all of our articles that you could download, free of charge, of course. And in about 2008, yeah, something like that, seven already, we had an idea that we both have been promoting teacher collaboration, and we have this experience with co-teaching. And we heard more and more about the New York City pushing approach to ESL and how much resistance there is out there to this way of servicing the children. And we knew that we could always tap into what's in special education. Inclusion has been around for a long time. And that's when Maria and I started talking, we need to write a book, because there's no book out there that would specifically address the needs of English learners in a collaborative program. And that's our first book.
Yes, that is.
Well, you have the next slide that maybe we could show.
Yes.
So which one that is. That's the collaboration.
Yes. And then knowing that people were interested in the research, because teachers today and administrators are very savvy about, all right, that's very nice. We know that this is a practice, but how do you know it works? Where's the research? So we decided to pull together this co-edited book that we have. So we have the brown book and the blue book.
Yeah, and it's interesting, the water theme is in both of them. Those are not our designs. That's the designs of the arts department in each of those two publishing companies. And interestingly, they both came up with the idea of how fluid it is, how it's a source of maybe the ripple effect if you just drop a pebble in there. Our collaboration and co-teaching will have an impact that we don't even see originally. And when we set out on this second journey, we knew that there's no way we can produce enough high-quality research alone. So we thought, let's just put out a call for proposals, call for submissions. Then we had invited authors, and we wanted to make sure that we have a whole range of voices represented and lots of regions of the country and also internationally. And that's how we met online or by email.
Yes,
yes, Gabriel, at that time from Uruguay. And we're very excited that we're going to have a South American story told in this book as well.
Okay.
As ESL teachers, you must have realia, right? So we're practicing what we preach. We brought our realia. Maria dashed into my house at 4 o'clock and said, do you have apples?
Of course, I forgot the apples.
We can't forget the apples. So another favorite, and you'll see why. If you have an apple and I have an apple, and we exchange these apples, then you and I will still each have an apple. Ta-da, we did it. Yeah, we are there.
Okay. But if you have an idea, and I have an idea, and we exchange these ideas, then both of us will have two ideas.
And we really live by this. And my husband could testify. I'm not going to put him on the stage here to do this. No, he drove us. He graciously agreed to drive and sell the books and just do the shopping and everything for it.
And the photography.
And the photography, too, for this event. But the moment we're together, it's like ideas just start sparking. So we live this, and many of our co-authors who are here are nodding that synergy that happens when people collaborate and work together is really captured by this George Bernard Shaw model.
Okay. As part of our work, what we in our first book, the brown book, we Our own research and experiences led us to identify two types of collaborative activities that take place for the sake of English learners. One we identified as instructional and the other non-instructional.
The instructional collaborative activities could take any one of these or a combination of these activities, such as joint planning, when teachers work together to plan their instruction and bounce ideas off of each other. When curriculum that is taught in the general education classroom and in the ESL or EFA class are aligned, mapped and aligned, is another very powerful professional learning opportunity for collaboration. Parallel teaching is what we call when the pull-out program or the self-contained ESL program continues. And in that context, what is happening in that classroom parallels, either based on skills or subject matter, what's happening in the other classroom. Do you want to continue?
Okay. Co-developing instructional materials. It's very important when teachers team in order to develop materials because they both understand different aspects of the student. The ESL teacher or the EFL teacher is very honed into the linguistic aspects of the student's progress, and the classroom or content area teacher is very focused on developing the student's knowledge of the content. So very often when teachers get together to develop material, the ESL teacher can be very helpful in modifying and identifying ways to differentiate instruction that's going to benefit all learners, in particular our English learners. Collaborative assessment of student work, again, what the ESL teacher sees, you know, so very often I've had memories of conversations with classroom teachers where I would go in and I'd say, oh, Jorge is doing so very well, don't you think? And the classroom teacher will say, how can you say that? He's not doing well at all in social studies and science. He's failing most of the tests. It's a perception of the ESL teacher often sees that linguistic progress and moving towards fluency and proficiency. And the classroom teacher, again, is not focused there, focused on the content. And then, of course, we have co-teaching, which is just one of the many types of collaborative activities that take place among teachers.
The non-instructional collaborative practices may include professional development activities that teachers jointly participate in, and in the co-edited book you will see examples of some of those practices, and you will see a lot of examples of teacher research as well, which we truly celebrate the authenticity and that responsiveness to the real classroom scenario that only the teacher who is an observer, a participant, and a researcher in that context can capture. Then preparing for joint parent-teacher conferences or writing report cards together, as Maria said, is an eye-opening experience when teachers exchange ideas and their assessment of students' work. And finally, any other extracurricular activities, which are also exemplified in this co-edited book in a number of different chapters, how teachers can decide and facilitate together various meaningful activities for the school community.
Well, this comes from our co-edited book, our blue book, from Nordmeyer and Mulazi. It is an identification of, first, what we see is a 20th century paradigm for teaching English learners. As you see, there is the students are in the middle, but there's two types of identification. We have the regular students and the ESOL students. We have the ESOL students just a part of the responsibility of the ESOL teacher. Okay? They don't seem to be the responsibility of any of the content teachers. Okay? So there's less access to the curriculum for these youngsters.
Thank you.
Now we have a paradigm shift.
Yes, yeah. So moving from the 20th century paradigm for servicing this population to the 21st century paradigm could truly be a shocking experience for some of us and some of our colleagues as well. But in the 21st century paradigm, collaborative teachers see themselves and see their entire school community very differently. Even though the diagram is almost identical, some subtle differences are visible. Here, the ESOL students or ESL students are not labeled, not identified, and not segregated in any way. They are part of that larger community. And as you could see, the teachers are also connected. They have that shared ownership and shared responsibility for instruction and for the students. So, here is one of our favorite activities. We thought that we just have to do this because we're traveling with this show around the country, and this is one of our favorite and best received activities. So we need 5 volunteers. I know I already have a voluntold. Yes, Audrey, I told Audrey you're going to volunteer. So we have, okay, come on up, the 2 gentlemen in the back. So we have 3, we need 2 more. 2 more volunteers, yes, we have 1 more. And the last chair is going to go to, were you just putting on your sweater or what? Oh, you really tricked me on that one, okay. We need 1 more volunteer. Do we have, oh yes, please, come. Yeah, come over here. Just, we have to be very careful with the wires. So would you mind pulling 2 more chairs here? Isn't that interesting? They think they're going to be sitting. Okay.
Like me to stand?
Yeah, we'll explain the game in a minute. Just, no, we only need 4 chairs and 5 people. What are we going to do? Yes. Yes, we're going to play musical chairs. We're going to play musical chairs using the regular, typical, well-known rules. What are the rules? Yes, when the music stops, you sit down, and what happens if you don't have a chair? You're out. Okay, so our 5 volunteers, get ready, get set. Is the music ready?
I hope so.
Okay, so here we go. Oh, all right. So please take a chair, pull it to the side, but don't go too far, okay? So no, don't go too far. You're out. I'm sorry, you're out. Take a chair, but stay close. Okay. Now, I forgot a very important part of this game. Because you didn't volunteer, you actually have a more important job to do. You have to watch everything that they do. Watch their faces, watch their actions, try to listen if they talk at all, what they are saying. So you have to make sure that you're watching everything that they're doing. Because after this game is over, we're going to play a second game. And then you really have to watch what they are doing. Okay, let's keep going. Now these days are gone. Okay, take a chair, sorry, and step to the side. Yeah, you need a chair. We have 2 chairs and 3 people. And you watch them very carefully. Not so self-assured. Aww, okay. All right. Thank you. 1 chair and 2 people. Go for it. Don't look. Okay, could you put the chairs back together the way they were? This was just part 1 of the game. Here is part 2. And now you have even more work to do. So please put the chairs back for the game. They're going to play the game again. But the rules will change. Same amount of chairs, same amount of people. This time, each time the music stops, they have to sit down. Everybody will have to sit down. but we keep taking the chair away until only one chair is left and they still all have to sit down. And your job is to watch. How do they behave now? Already, watch them now, watch them now. What changes? Okay?
Try to see it my way. Do I have to keep on talking till I can go on? While you see it your way.
Beautiful. Please take a chair to the side. And then continue. So we have, you're not out. You're still part of the game. You're not out.
Love may soon be gone. We can work it out. We can work it out. Think of what...
Okay. Thank you. One chair to be removed. One chair to be removed, and we have two chairs and five people.
What you're saying, you can get it wrong and still you think that it's all right. Think of what I'm saying.
Okay, and now one chair to be left, and all five of you to work it out.
We can work it out and get it straight, I'll say goodnight. We can work it out, we can work it out. Life is very short and there's no time.
I think they deserve a big round of applause, yay! Picture from this angle. Okay, so while they are doing the photo shoot or cleaning up, one after the other, you had an important job. You had to observe them. How did they behave? You don't go away yet. Okay, stay there. How did they behave the first time around? Passive? Okay, what else? What were they doing?
Independent?
Okay. Competitive? They did not look at each other. Great observation about their body language and their movement. Nobody was smiling. Okay. Okay, any other observations?
Someone
about
said anxious. I heard the word anxious.
More aggressive.
More aggressive. Was that an accurate description of you guys? Yeah, they accept that description. I guess it was pretty close then to what they were actually experiencing. Second time around, what happened?
They talked to each other.
Talked to each other. They were laughing. Helped each other. Friendlier. Yeah.
There was strategizing. Yes, they were.
Yes. Yeah. Very good. Any other observations? Yes. Okay. They became
more trustworthy. Trusting.
Trusting. Smiling more.
Yes.
And silly.
They were having fun.
They were having fun. Is that a good description the second time round? Yes? Anybody who actually played and volunteered, we're so grateful that you did. Would you like to comment on this experience? Have you ever done this before? No. Okay. Well, we have to give credit to Richard Villa, who is a special education inclusion guru. We learned this great game from him. But we, of course, take it into the ESL context. So anybody would like to comment on this experience?
We were strategizing. We were like, well, there's two handles, and then there's a back seat, and you can, you know, and then we were saying, oh, you can sit on my lap. It's okay. So take away that, like, oh, should I or shouldn't I? And we're like, so I thought that was.
See, just this very thing, you go first. We all felt that we were very, I felt everybody's very collaborative. You know, you can sit first or you can sit here or we come around and bend. Oh, we sit in the back of the chair also. So we were all giving each other like little hints and suggestions how to get the task accomplished within the boundaries.
And I think even though we all have the social good manners that we're not going to outwardly show aggression or competitiveness over a game of, what
musical
is it
chairs.
Musical chairs. no, but I think on a certain level you are kind of like, okay, I hope it lands with me. I mean, there's a little competitiveness there that you...
It's fun to be competitive, but it's fun when you have the ability to work with other people and share your success with everyone. And when you feel that when you succeed, everyone else will succeed. I went to a high school where it was, and it's just not fun. When I went to college, it was like, relax, everyone, you work with each other, you help each other, and it's just you lower the stress level, everyone has a good time, and you end up learning a lot more.
Well, I guess I have to speak, being that everybody else did.
Peer pressure.
Yeah, peer pressure. If I say no, I don't think that'll look so good on me. I would just like to say that there is two different styles. Obviously, working by yourself individually and then working with the team, it has its benefits because you can definitely bounce ideas off each other. And when you work together, there's an extra amount of a greater feeling that people get because you worked on something together, you created something, you know, with somebody else that you can share something with.
We did not set them up to say all these things. Yes.
At the end, I noticed that the women in a very subtle way kind of deferred to the men to have the chair, and it was just happening so beautifully and so naturally that I almost felt like that's the way it's supposed to be. So it was a little bit of gender stuff happening.
Well, not everybody agrees with that notion here. Let's leave it at that. I have actually another very, very important challenge for you, and then we'll still take some more comments, of course. What was this a metaphor for? We like to call this a musical metaphor. Collaborating.
Cooperating.
Somebody said harmony. Yeah, excellent. Very good. So creating harmony in the workplace. We can work it out.
A cohesive joint effort.
Jeannie?
Problem solving.
Great.
Negotiating.
Beautiful. Sometimes we, as we've told you, we always play this game. This just never fails. It's such a favorite of ours. We've taken it to Iowa and all the places that we go to. And some participants said, the ever-diminishing amount of resources we have in education. And so they keep taking away, you know, the budget cuts. We only have one chance left. Well, we're still going to make it work. And as teachers, we're survivors. We're going to just make it really work. And it worked for this group, too. So thank you so much again.
Thank you.
We really appreciate it.
So, one of our ideas about collaboration is that it really works toward building equity for English language learners, because it's no longer your students or my students. The students really become our students, and that is really one of the key goals of collaborative practice. Oh, okay. And then also, we have the idea that very often we see that there's that job division, remembering in the 20th century paradigm, each teacher has their own content area to do, and they remain separated from one another. But again, the idea is it's not your job or my job, it's our job to teach English language learners.
Well, this really simplifies the essence of our work and also what's in the co-edited volume. In an increasingly complex world, sometimes old questions require new answers. So we hope, as we're moving into the second segment of our presentation and very soon inviting our co-authors, contributing authors, to come up and be on a panel, each of their chapters was really tackling, and in an increasingly complex world, an old question: how are we going to best service this population? How are we going to do the very best job we can for English learners in the EFL or ESL context, and we did need a lot of new answers, and that's what is found in our book.
All right. We would like to invite you to our Facebook page and also to our website, which is coteachingforelds.weebly.com. And I think Andrea may have mentioned privately, I don't think you mentioned publicly, about our publications that are on our website. And so our articles are there for you to download. And also we have information on the Common Core, which is another really true hot topic for teachers.
Okay, and now we'd like to invite you to turn your attention to the handout that we gave you. This is actually the table of contents of our edited book, and we're so pleased to announce that many of our contributing authors are here. If you start from the top, in section one, we have chapters related to conceptual frameworks and models of collaboration, and we would like to invite Justin Santana and Jennifer Scully to join us up here. They are the representing authors from section one. Section two is titled Documentary Accounts of Collaborative Instructional and Leadership Practices. And we have Jeannie Faulkner from that section, chapter 12, Sharing Vocabulary and Content Across Disciplines. Section three is entitled Empirical Studies on Collaboration. And we're so pleased to have Christopher Stilwell here. Are you coming, Chris? Who was in Japan when he wrote this chapter? And Maria and I were so happy. We included everybody in the, you know, in the spirit of collaboration and inclusion. We invited everybody from Japan, from Alabama, from wherever they wrote chapters in, from New Zealand, from Australia. And to our surprise, look at that, Uruguay and Japan. We have certainly a wonderful representation of geographical diversity. So it's not just our New York friends who are here. And then the last section of the book is called Collaborative Practices to Support Mentoring and Professional Development. And we have Patty St. Jean Barry here and Gabriel Díaz Maggioli. Is there anybody hiding in the audience? Hope not. We had over 30, 40 authors, so we're so pleased that all of you are here. And this is what we had in mind. We wanted to first invite everybody to introduce themselves so you could get to know them. You got to know us a little bit, so we certainly would like to share the spotlight with everybody. If you could first just go around and introduce yourselves. We were told to remind you to speak into the microphone so the recording could come out good.
I'm going to speak into the mic. My name is Jocelyn Santana, and I am a high school principal in Brooklyn, and one of the co-authors with the wonderful Jennifer.
I loved co-authoring. I highly recommend it. My name is Jennifer Scully. I've been working in ESL since 1992. Is that better? My name is Jennifer Scully. I've been working in ESL since 1992 in various contexts. At the time, I was working in an early childhood school when we wrote the chapter together. And it was a very interesting experience to see co-teaching and collaboration in action.
Thank you.
My name is Jeannie Faulkner. I have only been involved in education since 2003. I had a prior career in business, where collaboration has a whole different meaning. And but there are parallels, and there are definitely applications. I worked in secondary ed and was in an international, not in the international high school system, but in an international high school when we did this project.
Hi, I'm Chris Stilwell, and at the time of writing the chapter, I was assistant director for a language program at a university in Japan, but I'm coming back to the States now, and I'll be starting a PhD in education in California soon. So that's how I was able to be here. So, very happy to be here. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Patty St. Jean Barry, And I always feel like I need to say this. I'm not an ESL teacher by training, but I'm an ESL teacher by heart. And I work in a community that has a very diverse population, so I needed to learn about how they learn. And so currently, I'm a literacy coach in a high school on Long Island.
Well, you know me. Now, in this incarnation, I'm working here. In my previous incarnation, I was leading the national reform on the level of teacher education in a country that has a centralized educational system, national curriculum, and one teacher education college for the whole country.
So thank you again for being here, for agreeing to serve on this panel. And next, if I could invite you to very briefly summarize your project that's presented in your chapter. What was unique about the collaboration or co-teaching that is presented in your particular chapter? And we don't even have to go around. Anybody who is just ready, if you might need a little more time to think it through, what you'd like to share about your chapter. Anybody can just take it away.
So our chapter is chapter 6, which is the co-teaching for English language learners, recommendations for administrators. The other co-author who's not here was actually also a principal at the time. When we wrote it, I was supporting her under a position called deputy network leader. You know, the Department of Education has this very strange positions that we go in and out very quickly. So, of course, I knew Jennifer from MA TESOL and just doing work through ELS, through the ELS community. And, of course, I worked with this particular principal, and one of my jobs was to support her, support the beginning of a collaboration between her ESL teacher and somebody else, another teacher. So as I was struggling to support her, you know, she started to keep a just kind of a daily anecdotal, and then she said, "Jocelyn, you know, this really it's something that when I was trying to find out support for in the literature, just asking people, I couldn't really find anything. So, you know, since you're always thinking about writing stuff, here's some notes that I took." So anyway, that was kind of the birth of the idea, in a sense. And then eventually we got the invitation, which was almost like, oh my God, this is supposed to happen. So the summary in terms of the article, basically our recommendations, of course, for administrators like myself into what we, the mistakes that we should avoid, kind of the do's and don'ts, and of course, you know, things like ensuring that co-planning time, which is very, very expensive. Now that I've been a principal for 2 years, it's amazing how expensive some of these practices can be when you're really out of the money. But, you know, if the commitment is not there, it's not going to happen. So thus, if we wanted to work, the commitment has to be there for co-planning time for the teachers. The kind of the other big idea of the article is this whole notion of really getting away from helping teachers to see that it's our students, not just my student or the ESL teacher's responsibility, particularly through the observation model. I mean, I go into a classroom, I have to observe two teachers. So this whole notion that you're only observing one or the other, it really doesn't make any sense. So there's a brief kind of protocol that provides some guidance to administrators when they go in and looking at two teachers teaching the students that belong to both of them and for whom they're both responsible.
Yeah. Thank you. Okay, who would like to go next? So Jennifer, would you want to add anything to that?
Just that it was interesting that the school that inspired me to write about my experiences as a teacher in a collaborative setting, I worked at one school where the experience was decidedly negative, and then a second school where it was much more positive. And I knew that we had done something wonderful when I was observed at school number 2, the wonderful school, and knew everything that the person was going to ask me during the observation and was prepared. And I said, "Look, I have this." And she said, "That's where I got it from." And I was like, "Oh my gosh," you know. So being observed and knowing what the expectations were was very fulfilling experience for me as an ESL teacher. So I think what we did was really great, and I'm very proud of it.
Thank you. Thank you, Jeannie. You're ready?
Sure. So ours is chapter 12, sharing vocabulary and content across the disciplines. My co-author is a math teacher. She's in Utah doing math things right now, so she couldn't be with us. And we worked together in a school where 50% of the population are L's, so we did have a lot of commitment to supporting L's. We also did have common planning periods, which made life easy. What we wanted to share, though, was we brought together five disciplines in collaboration to teach what we, in a method we call mini immersion. We're creating mini immersion because what we believe is that by using shared concepts and vocabulary to create meaning in different contexts, you create a greater understanding of the language and a greater ability to use the language. You don't have to learn a whole set of vocabulary in every single class to start making sentences, and we all taught newcomers. In our chapter, we have an example from Living Environment, where we took the content and vocabulary from Living Environment. I used it in the ESL class. I happened also to be the ELA teacher in our particular structure, so I used it in the study of poetry and drama. The math teacher taught statistics, graphing, using an analysis of predator and prey patterns of behavior. And in a separate, so that's four. But in a separate scenario, we did the planning together, and we did a similar set of activities with the social studies teacher. And in each case, we considered the content areas, science and social studies. We considered the rest of us, if you think about the SIAP model, the supporting area in SIAP is the ESL, supporting the content area. What we consider novel, and really we'd like all of you to go bingo, is that math and English have the same ability to support the content areas because they can use any content to teach their content. So we have a paradigm in here, which we hope you will look at and incorporate. And kind of the last message I would leave is we had a special situation of support from the administration. You don't have to jump in and do a big thing with five disciplines. You can do it incrementally. You can even do it alone. You can collaborate alone. Go get the textbook from the content area and start creating lessons with that content. You don't have to teach the content. You use the language, you create meaning, you enable them to start talking about it, and they get better grades.
Thank you.
So my chapter was a little bit different in that it was in Japan, as we mentioned. And so the situation was I was one of the administrators coming in and starting kind of a new language program. So this university had existed for a while, but the language classes that they were having were kind of typical of Japan from maybe 20 years ago. So it was not communicative language teaching. It was kind of grammar translation. Language classes were not required. There was basically a very big cultural change was happening. The president of the university decided that they wanted to have a big push for English. And so it was our job to go in and change the culture. And so we observed classes that were being taught, and we saw that it was, you know, maybe 100 students in a class, grammar translation, and we were going to change this. We're going to have maybe 20, 30 students in a class, and we're going to ask them to communicate, to actually talk to each other, not just copy sentences onto the board and things like that. And we thought, well, we want to do everything we can to make this program a success, so maybe team teaching will help also. And so we were about 15 teachers, I think, from various parts of the world. Only one of them was Japanese. The rest of us were from Australia, New Zealand, all over the place. And it was quite an experience. And so my chapter kind of reports on this experience of trying to set up a program like that. And the data that I use is survey data. So For the teachers who participated, I asked them to fill out a few different surveys at the beginning of the semester, during the semester, and afterwards. And also at the end of the semester, we asked the students to fill out some surveys about the program. The students were very, so long story short, the students were very positive about the changes that happened. They enjoyed English and voluntarily signed up for the second semester. First semester was required. Second semester was up to them, but most of them stuck around. And when we asked them, not all the students had team teaching. We decided to have team teaching only for the students that were in kind of the lowest tier of each group. And we thought maybe that extra support would be nice. And so I was able to compare students who had been team taught with students who had not been team taught. And the students who had been team taught were very enthusiastic about it and said, yes, I'd like to have two teachers in the classroom next semester. The students who had not been team taught said they didn't care if they were team taught next semester or not. So everybody seemed to be happy with the status quo. The teachers, on the other hand, were less happy about the team teaching, I'm sorry to report. They found it quite a challenge. And so in the chapter, I speculate about why this might have been a challenge for them. And I think one of the biggest challenges was, typically with team teaching partnerships, you have somebody, maybe a math teacher partnering with a language teacher or something like that. And in our case, it was a language and a language teacher in every case. And so there was maybe less of a feeling that they were benefiting so much from the partnership. Not everybody felt the same way, but maybe that's part of it. Also, it was just a lot of pressure to get a program off the ground. And so anything that was perceived as taking away from the time, I thought that this would make things more efficient for everybody, but not everybody saw it the same way. The other challenge was that many of the partnerships involved maybe someone who was kind of had seniority paired with somebody who was brand new. And so it was also perhaps a feeling that teachers were being spied on or something like that, which was not the intention. It was meant to help them get used to the culture. But it was interesting to see how this wonderful idea could have some complications hidden in there somewhere.
Thank you.
Well, in 2006, a catastrophic event happened in my school. We got a Reading First grant. I don't know if you're familiar with Reading First grants. It's the funding stream from NCLB. And so at the time, I was a reading teacher, and I just thought this was the absolute worst thing that could possibly happen, because our school was had half of our classes as bilingual classes and a considerable caseload of kids in ESL. And if you know anything about NCLB, all the children in the school must be assessed regardless of how long they've been in the country, and actually we're moving more towards that every day. And so it was a very, very scary idea for me. And so I was asked if I would like to be the literacy coach and move from the classroom to doing staff development. And the only reason that I said I would do it is because I didn't want anybody to tell me how to teach my reading classes. So I figured I better become the literacy coach so I won't get bossed around. So we enter into this adventure, and it's very frightening and very heart-wrenching to give all tests in English to children who do not speak English. And so one of the things that I thought was, we really need to learn about what are the best ways to teach these children. All of us, not just the bilingual teachers, not just the ESL teachers. So my chapter's entitled, In Our School, We All Teach ESL. Because what I did as the coach, one of the many things, I had many, many jobs, but I decided to have a voluntary teacher study group. And we met once a month for 4 or 5 years. I can't remember, because then I got moved, and so when I moved, they stopped. But so for 4 or 5 years, once a month, we would have a meeting, and we would explore different topics. And there was gen ed teachers, ESL teachers, bilingual teachers, administrators, and we would come together and make sure I have like coffee and cake and stuff, because then people will come. And what we did was we talked about many different of the issues. We read We shared many, many topics over those years, and what the chapter focuses on are some of the ways that Gen Ed and ESL teachers did collaborate as an outcome of that experience. And one of the things that we really learned, that we took away from it, was that really what we were learning about the strategies for ESL children, it's really, those are strategies that are good for everyone. And so it really benefited everyone to take that time. And so it's about how we collaborated in our study group, and it's how from that experience teachers started to collaborate in the classroom as well. And probably the most important thing, and I think I've heard many of you saying that today, is that we started to have this shift from, you know, being that that's the ESL teacher's problem to that these are all of our kids and we all have to be invested in what they're doing. And so I've become very involved in TESOL since then, not really on purpose, but it just kind of led me there because I realized that mainstream teachers really need to be a part of this conversation.
Thank you. Last but not least.
Well, how do I explain this to you? Because the reality I come from is totally alien to you. No resources for English language learners, very little or no administrative support, high stakes testing, in a country that is Spanish-speaking, considers itself monolingual, but half of the country speak a dialect of Portuguese. And the Minister of Education, decided overnight that every child starting at age 5 would learn English through immersion. Lo and behold, they would spend half of their school day learning maths and science in English, and the rest of the day learning language arts and social studies in Spanish. One of the things that the ministry was not aware of is that there were no qualified English language teachers in the country. So 6 years into the program, after millions of dollars of expenses in resources that were useless, they realized that they had to test the students a little bit more so that the teachers would start owning up, right? Nobody looked at the fallacy that nobody started looking at the fallacy that we only have in the whole of the educational system, K through 12, only 18% of the people who are in English language classes have gone through an English language preparation course. So when I applied for a position, and everybody said, you're crazy, and yeah, I have to admit I was, to coordinate the teacher education in foreign languages in the country. I started looking at the numbers, and I started becoming concerned. There is an Italian illustrator, his name is Tonucci, and he has a wonderful cartoon that says why students don't learn. So there you have the university professor pointing the finger at the secondary school teacher who's kneeling and asking for forgiveness, who in turn turns around and points the finger at the primary school teacher and the kindergarten teacher, who points the finger at the parents, who point the finger at the teacher educator, right? So it's the perfect cycle. So what we did was, at the same time, the Primary Education Council, we were through councils, lots of political positions. The Primary Education Council and Secondary Education Council decided to implement a mentoring scheme, which was actually a series of visits or raids, as teachers called them, where supervisors would come into the class, and these supervisors were not qualified, were not properly trained to support and inspire collaborative practices. Our educational system is totally balkanized. If you have read the work of Andy Hargreaves, he uses the term because everybody takes pride in the fact that you can close your classroom door and do whatever you want with those kids, and you don't let anybody into the classroom, neither the principal nor the supervisor. And that leads to isolation, and of course, all the evils of isolation. So we started sort of grassroots movement with people who were in supervision and wanted to learn more about mentoring. And the chapter reports on a 2-year process by which our aim was to do a cascade training of mentors, if you want, at the beginning training, but then very grounded knowledge production. The first cohort was comprised of a few future mentors who, after taking an online course with lots of reflective practice, would come together for a meeting, on-site meeting, where everything they had learned and assumed about mentoring would be shattered. And from there, they would write a book on mentoring, which we called Mentoring in a Mint. And basically, everybody took an aspect of mentoring with which they found difficulty. And that became, their task was, in order to benefit from this professional development, they had to commit to writing the chapter, completing the course, writing the chapter, and train 10 of their colleagues, of their choice, whom in turn would receive a copy of the book, would get free training, and would have to commit themselves to training 10 of their colleagues, and so forth, so on. Our aim was, in less than a year, to have somebody in every school who was knowledgeable about English language learners, and that would be able to support not just the professional development, but actually the learning of those kids. So the chapter reports on the lessons learned from every perspective, administrators, teachers, mentors, and a little bit of the teacher educators who are involved in the process.
Thank you so much. Now you see why we were so excited about putting this book together. And we also have to tell you that there were so many, many, many proposals we had to turn away. Simply, we could not include 40, 50, or 60 chapters in a book. That would have been really very big. So it was a very hard job for Maria and myself to select and organize the chapters that you would have, the readers would have, a good cross-section of what kind of challenges. We were very honest. We were not turning away people because they were reporting about challenges. We didn't want to sugarcoat this, that this is going to be your next silver bullet. All you need to do is collaborate. We really wanted to paint an honest picture and invite our authors to do so. So what I'd like to do now is invite you to more formally ask any questions of any of us, and then after a short while, we're going to turn it into a more informal kind of interaction, and we'll no longer sit up here, but we'll mingle with everybody. So
we have a couple of handheld mics, so if you raise your hand, you'll get a microphone so that your voice can get recorded in the film.
Okay, anybody? What film? Yes, we're getting recorded here.
Thank you. My name is Merrick. I'm an ESL teacher. I want to refer back to the musical chairs and ask a question about that in terms of deciding, making precise the decisions about collaborating. I think it must be the most difficult part of collaborating because in the musical chairs game, your instructions and the goal was very clear so that people could collaborate. And could anyone talk about how to create clearly defined goals so that people can collaborate easily?
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah,
if you are familiar with Andrea and Maria's book, Co-Teaching and Collaboration, there are, is it seven models? Numbers are not my forte.
Yes, seven co-teaching models.
Seven models. And so actually, as the coach doing professional development, what I did in my school was I created a template for creating a co-teaching lesson plan. And so the models are on the back of the form. And so as they're planning the lesson, the teachers would decide who was going to take what role in the lesson. And so they wouldn't always have the same role, you know, mm-hmm. So they would be seven different models so in this common planning tool for the whole school, you know, it's they would know that these are our options. And also it kind of got out there that it's not that the mainstream teacher is always the lead or and the ESL teacher follows, depending on the purpose of the lesson. It's more appropriate for one or the other. And then we started talking more about, well, what's the purpose of the lesson, which was kind of a new idea for some people. So their book is a wonderful resource for that, and we used it for that purpose.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I have to say that frameworks are very important for conversations, but also you have to also have a collaborative attitude. You cannot be married to your ideas. You cannot believe that your ideas are the best ideas in the whole world and no one would have a better idea. I mean, Andrea and I, we write together all the time. And we edit each other's work. And when I hand her a chapter that I've written, I say, you know, and she'll say, well, she has an idea. I say, I'm not married to anything. Mm-hmm. And that's what you have to develop. That's difficult for some people. You know, ego is involved. And so, yes, there are some other, you know, psychological and sociological, implications to a collaborative, environment. So, yeah.
I think often we also talk about how collaboration has to be about some kind of compelling importance. You have to choose a goal. You have to have a common goal. And then based on that common goal, in all of these chapters, that common goal was different.
Absolutely.
Really different, what you just heard them present about.
But it's not the only form. Mm-hmm. And there are ways to be much more. It's the form that requires you to be most in the nest together, I would say. Most in sync, but there are many other forms of collaboration where people whose personalities are more independent can still collaborate and be productive.
And if I could just add, my belief is that basically people need to be voluntarily committed to collaborate. We've had experiences where we had contrived collaboration. We had to sit down at a certain time to plan together. And that never worked. Okay, people just sat down, they would write something together, but the student was invisible, right? It was like, I have to get through this administrative commitment and that's it. So the first thing is look for addicts, right? Look for people who have a passion for the child and for collaboration and go from there. And then nothing succeeds like success, right? So once you see these groups getting formed and everybody tagging along and being happy, people just join.
I think I have the mic.
Oh, yes. Right there,
okay.
Sorry.
I collaborate with myself, which is to say that I teach a content course, an ESL content course on New York City history. So when I get into the classroom, I'm never quite sure whether my goal is to drive on with the city history and finish the lesson, or to back up and get more inclusion and more time for them. And I feel like I'm not sure where my balance is. I know that the administration, you know, hired me to teach New York City, you know, then and now, but I just wondered if you had some help to offer me.
Yeah, sure.
So it sounds a little less like collaboration and more classic content teaching via ESL, and that's always a difficulty, and you're pulled in the two directions. Do I go towards the language or do I go towards the content? And what you might want to do is look at the material involved with the content and try to determine things like what grammatical structures will the students need to learn in order to master this content, in order to express what they've learned. What are the most frequently used or most powerful vocabulary items that will push the student furthest towards mastery of the content? That sort of thinking about the structure of the content, the linguistic structure of the content, will help you to develop a course like that. But it might be interesting for you as well to work with a colleague who's a straight history teacher to get their idea. There's an interesting chapter in a book I read about the grammatical structures involved with teaching history, the past tense, the present perfect tense, and the past perfect, which is one of the most difficult, I'd say. And that's how I would conceptualize it. That's how I've done it. But collaborating with a history teacher might be interesting for them as well. So good luck.
I'd also like to point out a chapter whose authors are not here, but we wanted to make sure that 21st century technology is also included. So chapter 10 is on e-collaboration, connecting ESL teachers across context. Yeah. These three teachers were part of a course, just like maybe many of you are connected to a new school program now, and then they went off on their own, and they stayed in touch through Google Docs, Dropbox, emailing, staying in touch, and just simply sharing ideas, or just as you said, what am I going to do? What should I do? And just dropping each other notes and soliciting feedback in a very non-threatening way. Maria and I sometimes call it just collaborative conversations. Just have a talk with a colleague you trust. Yes. Just like here, you raised an issue. And there's another very interesting idea that we've learned also from Richard Villa, collaborate with your students. If you have nobody else to collaborate with, yeah, as a teacher, setting up some sort of a jigsaw exploration about New York City, or tapping into their funds of knowledge, recognizing their expertise, that they might know something about a part of the city which we might not be visiting or would not know much about. So that's another interesting concept. So collaboration is, the possibilities are endless. We're just getting more and more excited about this. Okay, anybody else has a question? Yes. Sorry, the mic is getting over to you,
sir. Coming. Thank you. Oh, this works great. I just wonder if there have been studies as to which schools and settings are more amenable to cooperation. Is there any characteristics that common among schools which are amenable to collaboration? And that's all.
Well, that's an excellent question, because when Maria and I first set out on the journey of the first book and we presented it to Corbin Press, that was our first publisher, the editor asked the same thing. Is it just a New York thing? Or is there anything else out there? Has anybody else published on this? Like, why do you want to do this book? And that's what prompted us to really do our homework and do our research and have an answer to your question. So what we found was that one of the most frequently cited or described school districts in the country is St. Paul Public Schools, spps.org. If you have not been visiting different schools' websites, this would be one interesting website to visit, spps.org, St. Paul Public Schools in Minnesota. And it's a huge school district with a lot of immigrant, migrant, and refugee students coming from around the country. There's a huge, one of the largest Hmong population and Hispanic speakers, as well as many other speakers there. And what they have done is they restructured top down. They restructured the entire school to be completely collaborative. If you want to teach there, if you want to work in that context, you will have to buy into the philosophy. So it became a collaborative vision and mission for the school where there is absolutely no pullout. It's not an option. Pullout is not an option. If you want to work here and service these children, whether they are gifted or special needs, or ESL, or AIS, whatever services you're providing, you're going to be providing it in the classroom with the teacher. So the answer to that is that there are some, and then the collaboration results in amazing test scores for these kids. They are this close to closing the achievement gap. Everywhere else in the country, you're talking about huge gaps in math and ESL. In St. Paul Public Schools, it's a few digits. So why? they don't know more about PSYOP, or they don't know more about vocabulary. They have a video that we watched that they put out. What they do differently is creating this collaborative school culture and environment, where then collaboration will become the way we do things. That's the norm, rather than an add-on or a challenge that we just can't overcome.
Andrea just mentioned school culture, and just looking at it a bit broader, schools that have cultures, certain types of cultures, really are better prepared to collaborate than others. I remember I had the pleasure of spending a day at one particular school on Long Island. It was a small school, and I was in one of the, it was a faculty meeting that I actually was in. And the teachers felt so very comfortable with their administrator. They were very able to tell that administrator anything that they were thinking and feeling, very respectfully, mind you. However, that form of trust, there was no gotcha, you know, there was no fear in these teachers. And I just remember observing and writing about it. It was really remarkable. And then, of course, been in other situations where the teachers are closed mouth, won't say a word when an administrator is in the room, won't say a word even because they're fearful of what their other colleagues might think or say about them at a later date. So culture is truly key when you're talking about trying to build a collaborative practice.
For me, one of the biggest things as an ESL teacher was learning to trust my students. And that, I think, is something that I think ESL teachers have that maybe other discipline teachers do not have. And we, and I remember my first year or my second year teaching with the Board of Education, and somebody came in and observed me, and she said, "You don't trust. Why don't you trust your students?" Well, they don't know this, they don't know that. And I think that that's experiential. So now I totally trust my students. And maybe other people don't understand what's going on in the classroom, but I don't. And the result of that is a flip. Then they trust you, and then they're so interested and eager to learn. So we've had experiences. I've had experiences with other ESL teachers where we go and someone talks at us. And we sit around and we say, "This is so old-fashioned. What are we doing sitting here while people talk at us?" So, I mean, I'd be interested to see how you kind of bridge that gap between that commitment, the strong commitment, which I think most ESL teachers have to trusting the students and getting their feedback from where they're at. I mean, it's kind of amazing to me as it goes on. Now I have a class of many Chinese students, and they're sharing all sorts of things with me about Chinese culture that I never thought I would learn, but it's because I have that mindset, and so that starts with day one. And so I don't know if that's, if there's a conflict there, but I think that's what the ESL teachers have to offer.
Yeah, thank you. A thought that was triggered in my mind as you were sharing was how Maria and I co-presented a professional development session a while ago, and we had one administrator in the room and about 50 teachers. And it was about the Common Core standards. And the teachers complained. They were raising some issues, I would say. And the administrator came to us in the break and said, "I'm leaving because there's too much venting. You're allowing this session to be hijacked." And Maria said, "We did not think so." I think, what did you say? You want to just comment on? You said that you have to listen. Anything has to start by listening. If you refuse to listen, the way you were listening to your students, they trusted you because you wanted to hear their voices. So that any kind of collaboration or conversation must start, right? You remember?
Yeah, now you remember. In fact, it was Michael Fullan. In his book, I think, New Meaning of Educational Change, who said you have to listen to the naysayers. Because if you don't, you won't be able to actually capture what the problems are, and you won't move forward in solving them. So you have to listen to people who don't jump on the bandwagon right away, because they have really good reasons very often why. You know, I remember doing some research upstate in one particular middle school, and one administrator was horrified that I was going to interview this one teacher who everyone said, oh, he's always, you know, disgruntled, he's always, you know, doesn't want to do anything we suggest. And you know, I listened to him for 45 minutes, and he told me he had had 6 different assistant principals in the past 6 years. He also said that he went through different initiatives. Every year, for 8 years, they changed the program. And now they want to bring in this new program. So why should he be so, you know, thrilled? Because he knows that next year it's going to change. So right then and there, if you don't listen to that, if you don't hear that, then you're never going to solve the problem and get people on board. So it's very important to listen to the naysayers, as Fullan would say.
I think we'd like to wrap up this formal section of our evening, and we would like to invite you to stay. We have lots of refreshments and wine. We have some more stashed away, so in the chilling bucket, so please stay. You did not know that, right? It's still there. We have a few more copies of the book left, so we're just so pleased that you were here. Maybe, Gabriel, you wanted to wrap up the evening, too?
Yeah, I just want to thank everybody for coming, and Maria and Andrea especially for accepting the challenge to put this session together. And we did it!